Hi, and welcome to this week's episode of The Shtick. We always have interesting topics, subjects, and guests, and this week is no exception. To start the show off, we're in the studio with Myer Bloom. Hello, Myer.
G'day, Henry.
Nice to see you here.
Thank you. Yeah.
We've known each other since uni days.
I think you're a mere 40, probably 50 years
yeah,
ago.
About that. And we've always just said, hello, how are you going? Part of the passing crowd. And now I just was informed that you've got this book coming out called Sephardi Narratives. And what's that all about?
Sephardi Narratives from Australia. Yes, I've interviewed a number of people from Sydney and Melbourne who have Sephardi background or come from Middle Eastern and Arabic countries, who grew up in those countries, were mostly expelled from those countries, and eventually migrated to Australia. And little of their stories has been told before from their own personal points of view. So I've interviewed them like an oral history style interviews, and their stories are in the book.
Yeah, because Sephardi actually refers to people who were expelled from Spain around the 1492 period and ended up being dispersed.
Yeah. I mean, technically, Sephardi, yeah, that's what the Jews called Spain, but a lot of those people moved to other, ended up in other places like Turkey or especially Greece, especially Salonika, and because they were the majority, those communities sort of became Sephardi. And really, as I explain in the book, I mean, it's just a word used as a default in a way, because otherwise you'd be mentioning every type of Jew and not non-Ashkenazi, and Sephardi is just a shorthand way to refer to those Jews who lived in those sort of Middle Eastern countries.
And many of them went south as well. They went to North Africa.
I've spoken to people from a lot of those North African countries, Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, and Egypt, of course.
And Libya.
Yeah, a couple of Jews in Sydney from Libya.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because each one of those countries had quite a substantial Jewish population, and they were integrated happily for hundreds and hundreds of years.
Very substantial, especially in Tripoli and Libya, especially in Baghdad, and in Greece, of course, and Cairo and Alexandria as well. Jews were very integrated and very influential in business and commerce and social and economic aspect of society there.
Yeah, well, most of us know about the Holocaust that occurred in Eastern Europe and Germany and throughout Europe. But at the same time as the Holocaust was going on in Europe, there was, in a sense, a Holocaust going on in all the Arab countries.
Well, I mean, the Nazis intended to get at the Jews in all countries. That was on their list, all those sort of countries. And in some places, especially in Iraq, where they were very influential under the influence of the former Mufti of Jerusalem. He influenced the media there in Iraq. And one of the things that happened in Iraq was a big pogrom in 1941, where hundreds of Jews were killed. They were sort of, the people were inspired, to use that word, to attack the Jews. And there were other places too where Jews suffered during the war, and also they were deported and sent to camps, just like the European Jews. They're only a small proportion of the 6 million, but they're a significant proportion.
Yeah, well, it turns out that in the last few years, I've been following this story because I never knew anything about it. And I think a lot of people are now aware that there were over 800,000 Jews, the ones that survived the genocide. It was genocide in a sense, or a very rough treatment, because they were affected or influenced or incited by the German Nazi thing against Jews. They thought, well, if the Jews are that bad, let's get rid of them and take their property, which is what they did.
Especially after 48, when Israel was declared.
Yes.
That's when it got very bad. And there were nearly a million Jews in those areas before the war. But after Israel, 1948, it got pretty bad. Zionism was even made like a capital crime, I think, in Iraq. And over the next 20 years, probably about 700,000-800,000 Jews were basically ethnically cleansed from those countries.
Mm.
And some of them, a lot went to France, Israel, even South America, but a small proportion did come to Australia. A lot of Egyptian Jews went to Adelaide, some Iraqi Jews in Sydney, and Egyptian Jews in Melbourne, and
We have to mention that there were this aspect of Jews called the Mizrahi, who in the definition of Mizrach is the East, and they were the people from Yemen and Iran, and they also had, in a sense, their own programs.
I mean, look, Jews had lived in a lot of those countries for since temple times, especially Iran, Persia, even parts of North Africa, and it's, you come across in the literature, you know, the golden age of these Jews living there, and they did live well for a lot of the time, and they integrated, but they also suffered attacks and pogroms depending on who the rulers were at the time, what was happening politically. So it wasn't like smooth sailing for thousands of years. There were pogroms in Morocco, there were attacks in other countries, but There were different Jewish groups in different countries, Mizrach and Romaniot Jews in Greece, but as I say, it's just easier to group them under that Sephardi title to sort of keep it all, you know, so you can understand it all, yeah.
One of the people in this book who I knew well, a family friend, was Lola Putt, and she came from Salonika, which was predominantly a Jewish town in Greece, and it was a very important port, a trading port, and the Jews had that, and then the Nazis came and took her to Auschwitz, and there's a story about her journey to Auschwitz, where she met my mother. So my mother and Lola knew each other in Auschwitz, and then ended up in Melbourne in the same social group, and I bought my first car from Maury Putt, who was her husband, her late husband. We were all family friends. The other person mentioned in this book is Marcel Levy, who's the mother of my mates, Jack and Eddie Levi. Also, Jack is also known as Elliot Goblet. Right. So it's a really interesting book. You've edited all the interviews that you did. It's fantastic. And there is going to be a book launch on the 23rd of February at the Sephardi Shul at 79 Hotham Street, Nice and Kilda. The shul's called Sassoon Yehuda. It's such a oriental name, isn't it? It's fantastic. And that's going to be on Sunday at 4 p.m., the 23rd of February. So if you want to support Maya's work and also follow this amazing story, it really is fascinating, isn't it?
It is, and it's very fascinating. I mean, I'm a very Ashkenazi background, but I found this whole thing fascinating because these people's stories are very different from our parents and our European background, and they're all very different. They don't all fit the same pattern, and they've had very interesting lives in the countries they grew up in, and they've had to change their lives a lot when they came to Australia. So they are really interesting stories.
Yeah, the other aspect we have to mention is that they spoke Arabic. They didn't speak Yiddish. The Eastern European had the Yiddish, and then there was the Ladino and the Arabic aspect of Judaism.
The interesting thing is some of these people weren't even aware of Yiddish and European Jews.
They had no idea. They didn't even know they existed.
Yeah, they were Arabic and Ladino speaking, yeah.
Anyway.
Languages too, yeah.
Yeah, well, we're coming back in the next segment with a really interesting fellow called Shimon Rihak, and he's going to be speaking about his experience as a child soldier in South Sudan and coming to Australia and becoming an Orthodox Jew. We'll be back after the break.